Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah was salatu was salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him for everything that He has given us, everything that He has bestowed upon us. For indeed He has given us more than we deserve. He has given us much more than we deserve. We praise Him for everything upon all conditions. For a believer, there is no condition that is negative. All the conditions are actually positive. It only depends how you look at it. It depends on the condition of your heart, and it depends on the condition of the iman of that particular heart, the belief of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us conviction. وأصلي وأسلم على أفضل الخلق وأكرم الرسل صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of creation, the most noble of all messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and his entire household, all of them without exception. May Allah bless them all. And may Allah bless all his companions without exception. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of you. And may he bless the ummah at large. And may Allah bless humanity at large. My brothers and sisters, it is important for us to make dua, to pray, to supplicate, not only for ourselves. We need to supplicate not only for the Muslims. We need to supplicate for the non-Muslims as well, to ask Allah to guide them. It is absolutely important for that. We need to have a feeling towards those who are humankind. And we need to have a feeling towards all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is when your heart is considered clean. All of us, at some stage, somewhere up the ladder, were not Muslimin. But someone loved us enough to bring the deen to us. Someone loved us enough by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His mercy, to be able to bring to us the beautiful deen that we happen to be having today. May we be from among those who can carry the same deen to the rest. May we be from amongst those who can carry the same deen in such a way that even the enemies of Islam realize that Islam is not a bad faith. Islam is not a bad religion. When the enmity of the enemy has decreased, we have already succeeded. Because you and I know, guidance is in the hands of Allah. The heart that I have cannot be guided by anyone besides Allah. We are taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the dua, the supplication he used to make regularly. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubana ala deenik. O Allah, in whose hands lies the turning of the hearts, turn our heart upon your deen. Make it firm and steadfast upon the deen. My brothers and sisters, we need to realize, call out to Allah to make your heart steadfast. And then work towards it. Try your best to achieve it. There is no point in making a dua when your heart is heading in the wrong direction. You say, Oh Allah, I ask you to protect me from drinking alcohol. And you have a bottle in your hand, you're about to open it and put it into your mouth. That is foolish. Oh Allah, protect me from stealing. And you are about to go and rob. No. But you say, Oh Allah, protect me from drinking. Protect me from intoxicants. Protect me from sinning. And you do something about staying away from it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us stay away from sin. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, this evening's talk is going to be very interesting and very different. I will be talking to my own heart, and you will be listening to what I have to tell my own heart. Part of the talk will be me speaking to my heart, and part of it may be a few words of advice for myself and for everyone else. So let me begin. Oh my dear heart, who am I talking to? My own heart. Oh my dear heart, there was a time when you did not exist. هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. Remember, O my heart, the verse in Surah Al-Dahr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, had a time not come or not passed upon man when he was nothing to be mentioned. O my heart, you were nothing to be mentioned at a certain stage. You were not in existence the way you are today. So before you were born, well before you were born, and even before that, Allah knows exactly when, the souls were not even created. Remember that. Then Allah created the soul, then Allah decided when to put you onto the earth for a purpose. Oh my dear heart, Allah put you on earth in order for you to leave the earth. Listen carefully, my dear heart. Allah put you on earth. You started pumping well before you had life. Oh my dear heart, you started pumping perhaps at a few weeks in the belly of your own mum, but at the same time the soul was blown at 120 days. Oh my dear heart, that is what we are taught by the one who made it. So the muscle that is known as the heart was given life at 120 days, even though it was pumping well before that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. And may Allah grant us ease. Oh my dear heart, you don't have a battery. You don't have any electric current. But you are pumping by the will of the one who made you. And if you stop pumping, you will be dead. Oh my dear heart, while you are pumping, you are just like an hourglass, an hourglass filled with sand, where the sand begins to go down. Oh my dear heart, one day it's going to stop, the sand is going to finish, and your test, your examination, oh my dear heart, will come to an end. So my dear heart, do as much as you can while you are alive. Go out, help. Go out and worship Allah alone. Go and spread the good news. Go and assist people. Do the best that you can. For before the entire game is over, you need to have scored the maximum number of goals for you to have won the match. Oh my dear heart, a day came when you were born, you came onto the earth. You were born in order for you to die. You were born, you started pumping, knowing that one day that pumping is going to stop. You knew that. And you will know it. And you know it now. And you know that a few days are remaining. Oh my dear heart, when I put my hand on you, I feel helpless. And I feel thankful to the Almighty, knowing that without any effort or energy of mine, you are pumping. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me purify my own heart and help every single one of us. Ameen. Oh my dear heart, you came to this earth knowing that you have to leave this earth. Just like you came in, you have to leave. Oh my dear heart, you came with no belongings and you shall leave with no belongings. It's only your deeds that will help you. Oh my dear heart, listen to what your Maker says. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created mankind or jinnkind except for the purpose of worshipping me. So my dear heart, worship Allah alone. That is your test. That is the reason why you are here. Your Maker, my dear heart, tells you that He will definitely test you. No matter what type of a life you are living, He will test you. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. We will definitely test every single one of you with a few tests. One of them is fear. Fear, subhanAllah. What type of fear? Every type of fear possible. We will test you with hunger. We will test you with the loss of life of those around you. The loss in terms of your material items, your worldly items, the produce, etc., etc. You have to be tested. That's why you are on earth. Oh my heart, you are not on this earth in order to enjoy as per your desire, but you are on earth in order to enjoy within that which Allah has made permissible. Why? Because He has made you, oh my dear heart. That's the reason. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ تَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Indeed, for Him is the creation, which means He created. And that is why He has the right to instruct. When He makes, He has the right to instruct. If you made something, you have the right to say what you want to do with it. Allah has created us. He has the right to decide why He created us. And He has the right to take us away. Oh my dear heart, you came onto this earth. You came onto this earth and that made the hearts of others very, very happy. Not realizing that you did not belong to them, you belong to the one who gave you the life. You know, when we are born, my mothers and sisters, my brothers and fathers, our moms and dads became happy, not realizing this child actually belongs to Allah. This is why when a person passes away, what do we say? We say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We belong to Allah. And unto Him is our ultimate return. That is what we say. Because we acknowledge that this is a worldly loss. But in the eyes of Allah, it's just the plan of Allah that keeps rotating and going on. People came, people went. People came, people went. You came, you went. I came, I shall go. Subhanallah. Those who come after us, they will be here for a while and then they will go. The timing of it, Allah knows best. When am I going to go? I don't know. I may not leave this stage. It's possible. You may not leave this hall. It's possible. May Allah grant us Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Oh my dear heart, you need to realize when you came onto the earth, other hearts became happy. But if they were connected to you very deeply in a way that would displease Allah, they would become depressed if the one who gave you the life took you back. What does this mean? My beloved brothers and sisters, do not become too attached to anything on earth. Do not become over attached, because when you lose it, you become depressed. People are sometimes attached to wealth. This attachment is such that if you realize where this wealth came from, who is the owner of it, and the fact that you are merely a custodian of this health, the day you lose it, you will not be depressed. You are just a custodian. When you have a spouse, you are only given the good fortune, perhaps, that's if they are good, by the way. You are only given the good fortune of being in their company for a short period of time. They have to go or you have to go. It cannot last on earth forever. But if you live your life in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He promises you that you will be together even in the hereafter. Amazing. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says.
وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاتَّبَعَتْهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتُهُمْ بِإِيمَانٍ أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ.
Allah speaks about how those who believe and their progeny followed them with belief, they will then be together in the hereafter. Remember that. You believed, you did good deeds. Your family believed, they did good deeds. Then you will be together in the hereafter. But if you believed and you did good deeds and your family members did not do good deeds, then subhanallah, Allah tells Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam,
إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ.
Your son, the fact that he has chosen besides Allah and he has decided to stay out of the ark, knowing that you are a messenger of Allah, knowing of the warning, that is his responsibility. He cannot be considered your son anymore when he is absolutely disobedient to Allah. You're going to lose him, not because Allah is not merciful upon you, but because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make things easy for us. So, oh my dear heart, learn a lesson from this. The attachment that you have and I have to this world is what depresses us the day we lose things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Oh my dear heart, as you grew older and as you grew bigger, as you grew bigger and older, oh my dear heart, your pumping changed. What happened? Suddenly, and this is something true, you became concerned about the physical heart more than the spiritual heart. You became concerned more about the physical heart than the spiritual heart. Oh my dear heart, do not suffer a spiritual heart attack, for indeed it is worse than the physical heart attack. My brothers and sisters, what is meant by this is when we suddenly have a pain on our chest. Imagine, I'm thinking about it so much that I almost said a chain on our chest. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. When we have a pain in our chest, what happens? Immediately we run. Where? To the doctor. We want to get it checked. What do we check? Cholesterol. Right? What is cholesterol? The thickening of the blood. You're eating too nice food. Don't you know that? The food you're eating, too much red meat perhaps, too many chocolates and sweets and milk and dairy products and whatever else, but you're indulging a little bit too much in worldly items. So Allah is just tapping you, hey, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. You went, you checked your cholesterol, very, very high. What happens? They've got to see for clogging, because if there is clogging, you need to be operated upon. Or you need a stent with the latest technology. Or you need something, because if not, your life is at risk. But oh my dear heart, your entire hereafter is at risk and you're not even worried. Your entire hereafter is at risk. No matter how much you go and remedy the physical heart, you can have the best specialists, have the top stents put in you, and you can have the bypasses that have bypassed whatever was blocked in your heart. Oh my beloved heart, I want to tell you that you still have to die. You still have to stop. There will be a point when you have to go. There is absolutely no way out. So now what? Oh my dear heart, don't be frightened. Don't be scared. Develop a link with the owner of the hereafter. The one who made you in the first place. You are going to go back to him. Develop a link with him. When you do that, you have no need to fear. You have absolutely no need to worry. Because you have a link with the boss himself. Subhanallah. You have a link with the creator and maker himself. What worry do you need? Subhanallah. This is why Allah speaks about the softening of the heart. How is the heart softened? And when we talk about softening, we're talking about getting rid of spiritual cholesterol. When your heart becomes heavy, you're enjoying too much on the earth. I'm too into worldly items. I love wealth so much that I will do anything to get it. I will be happy when there is pesos. And I will be sad when there are no pesos. Subhanallah. I will be happy when there is a beautiful car, a lovely watch, the latest phone, the best of smells, the best of handbags. Oh my beloved heart, that is a sign that you are sick. You are sick. What sickness? You are making your spiritual blood very heavy with spiritual cholesterol known as love of the world. When you're going to leave the world. كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ أَوْ عَابِرُ السَّبِيلِ. The Prophet, peace be upon him, speaks about how you will cleanse yourself, oh my dear heart, by being or living on this earth as though you are a stranger or just a passerby. When you're passing by, you and I know that we will not be able to carry everything with us. Nothing. You can have the latest iPhone, the latest Note 8. By the way, it's about to come out. The one where the battery does not explode anymore. You can have the latest Note 8, but guess what? If you die, people will be excited to collect it from you. Subhanallah. You can have the best perfumes. When you die, your family members, relatives, or maybe thieves might steal it. What happened to you? If you lived for that, you cannot take it when you go. You will not take it when you go, not at all. What will you take with you? Al-A'mal, that's it. Al-A'mal, that's it. The deeds, oh my dear heart, when you have separated from the body you are in right now. Here we're talking of the soul, knowing my mothers and sisters, my brothers and fathers, that Allah speaks about al-qalbu, which means the heart. Allah speaks about al-nafsu, which means the soul. Allah speaks about al-aqlu, which means the mind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about al-ruh, which also refers to the soul. And Allah interconnects all of them. Allah interconnects them in the Quran. And the reason why they are interconnected is because in reality they are. They are. You have a heart, you think with your mind. But when your heart is deep in something, it blocks the thinking of the mind. And when the heart is softened, it changes the way the mind thinks as well. If your heart is softened regarding something, your mind starts thinking in a different way. So there is a connection between the heart and the mind indeed, and the soul, subhanallah. Because the separation of the soul is at times connected to the heart. Not always, but at times connected to the heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. So, oh my dear heart, I have for you something very interesting. My dear heart, you need to know. You need to know, my dear heart, that you are going back to the Almighty without taking anything that you have amassed on earth. Nothing at all. What will you take? Your deeds. Because when the soul leaves the body, what will happen? As we go, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, your funeral is followed by certain items. It is followed by your family, your wealth, your deeds. What will happen? Your deeds remain with you, your family and your wealth. Go back. They will go back. Your family will go back. You have a husband, the best in the world. He will get married. Perhaps to the same woman you were fearing, he must not get married to. He probably will. Sorry, I don't mean to cause problems and issues here, but I'm just saying that. You had a fear that your wife might get married to someone. Yes, she will. Subhanallah. You died. What happened? It doesn't mean much anymore. Subhanallah. It shows that attachment is temporary because it was on earth. If Allah decides to make it eternal, He will. Under certain conditions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May He help us. My dear heart, never become too attached to anything. Realize and understand that you need to clean yourself. You need to clean yourself. The same way we have medication in order to thin the blood. The same way we have medication in order to thin the blood from the physical maladies and sicknesses, we also have medication to thin the blood from spiritual sickness and illness.
الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ.
Allah says, those who believe, their hearts are calmed by the remembrance of Allah. Did you hear that? Those who believe, they achieve contentment. Their hearts are calmed by the remembrance of Allah. For indeed, through the remembrance of Allah are the hearts calmed. It is through the remembrance of Allah that the heart is calm. So remember Allah. How do I remember Allah? The best form of remembrance is to read the word of Allah. Al-Quran. The word of Allah, it has in it so much of goodness. Imagine, He who made you spoke those words. It is known as Kalamullah. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they should bring a calmness even in the hearts of those who don't believe in it. When they hear the Quran, they are softened. Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq, Abu Jahl, and Abu Sufyan, before he accepted Islam, they used to tiptoe in Mecca, in the darkness, go and listen to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read the Quran. How lucky were they? But the condition of their hearts, they loved power, they loved money. That's why they rejected the truth. So, oh my dear heart, when you love power too much, you might be far away from Allah. You will suffer the consequences of it. You may get that power, but you will not be happy. You will not be content. When you love fame, and you want to be famous at any and every cost, you will not be happy. Perhaps you might become famous, but you will lose contentment, because you need to realize that when you love certain things, Allah will take you away from the connection with Him. You need to love Allah more than everyone and anyone else. If the power came and the fame came and the wealth came as a result of you loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, perhaps you will be assisted in it. Perhaps it will be a blessing. But if it came by you forgetting Allah, people start stealing, they start robbing, they start deceiving, they start fighting and killing and so on, and expect to get, wallahi, they might get something. When someone steals, what happens, my dear heart? Let me explain. When someone steals, they might achieve something, but they will be uneasy. The condition of the heart is very bad. They're not happy. They're always watching, always looking. When they use something they stole, they will always be uneasy. Oh my dear heart, when someone has committed adultery, remember, they will be upset. They will be unhappy after the few moments of stolen joy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Remember, my dear heart, you can never ever get purity by sinning against the one who made you. Every time you sin, my dear heart, a little black dot appears on you. And the more you sin, the more blackened the heart is until it becomes totally black. My brothers and sisters, you know, when you commit a sin for the first time, you feel embarrassed, you feel shy, you feel ashamed, you feel that something wrong has happened. You want to make amends, you want to go back to Allah. Why? Because there's one black dot. The rest of your heart is still clean. But you sin again and again and again, what happens? It becomes more and more darkened. Dark, so dark that there comes a time when you don't even worry. You look forward to the sin. You look forward to going to the clubs and dancing and jumping. Jumping for what, my dear heart? Do you think you're going to achieve the pleasure of the Maker by jumping and by shaking your hands and by moving to the left and to the right? Do you really think that? Oh, my dear heart, do you think you're going to achieve any form of goodness and purity and spiritual cleanliness from that spiritual cholesterol you have by listening to the doof and the doof and the doof straight into your ears, so loud that even your head starts shaking without you realizing? My dear heart, that's not going to clean you. That's going to make you even more dirty. That will addict you to coming back again and again. Achieving things the wrong way. You can get what you want the halal way, the permissible way. When Allah has given you instructions, my dear heart, it is only to keep you happy. It is only to open your doors, not to close them. So do it the right way, no matter how long it takes. You can become wealthy by stealing, but you won't be happy. But you can become wealthy by the will of Allah when sustenance is written for you through the halal means, even though it might take a little bit longer. So what? How many of us do we know who have not much, but they are happy? Their hearts are good. They're at ease. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, I was in Ghana a few days ago. And wallahi, at Salatul Fajr, when I got up 30 minutes before Salatul Fajr, I heard in the masjid, wallahi without a joke, I heard in the masjid a lecture going on with the loud speakers and hailers outside that are used for adhan. There was a lecture going on. The lecture lasted 30 minutes. The adhan went, I arrived in the masjid and the masjid was packed. Not one day, even the other day, and even the other day. Subhanallah. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm here in a country in Africa. Not a wealthy first world country, but a country that has its own struggles. A country that had and still has its own share of issues and matters that it needs to deal with. But look at the people. They are here at the time of tahajjud. And wallahi, I promise you, wallahi, I promise you, the masjid was full. Subhanallah. Oh my dear heart, you know, when I told you, where are you? Where are these people? Look at them. They are so happy, so content, sitting earlier than you, reading the Quran, achieving contentment, smiling. They must be all having problems. Not one of us can say, I don't have problems. Put up your hand if you do not have a single problem. Put up your hand. I want to see it high. Not one. Why? That is why, my dear heart, you were created to be tested. You will go through one issue, another issue, a third issue. Every time you have an issue, Allah wants to see what you do. That's all. And then you pass it to another test. The tests do not stop until you die. I'm at school. How can I think, okay, I'm still at the school and the tests will stop? They test you every week nowadays. Subhanallah. They test you every day nowadays. The better schools, as soon as they teach you a concept, they start testing you regarding that concept. Allah does the same.
Allah tests you regarding things. As soon as you know, when you say, I'm a mu'min, Allah says, I'm going to test you.
أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ.
The first few verses of Surah Al-Ankabut, where Allah says, Alif Lam Mim. Do the people think that it is enough for them to say we believe and then we're not going to test them? No! When you say we believe, that's when you've just entered the school. Did you hear that? When I say I have believed, that means I entered the school. Now I will be tested one after the other. The others, they are still outside the school. They may not be tested.
لا يغرنك تقلب الذين كفروا في البلاد متاع قليل.
Allah says, do not let the fact that the kuffar may be enjoying, they may be enjoying on earth, don't let that deceive you. That is just for a short period of time. They are enjoying. They have not even entered the test. They have not entered the test. People say, we are mu'mineen. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they looked at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they questioned, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are we not on the right path? He said, yes. Well, why are we struggling? Why all the suffering? That's because you're on the right path. It's like someone who goes into a school and he says, why all the tests? Well, because you are in the school. Subhanallah, that's why you're having tests. And then you will have a certificate. And then you get a more difficult test. And then you go to a higher level. And then when the examiners really love you, they ask you the most difficult question, so that if you are given an opportunity to pass it, and when you pass it, you have a PhD. Wow. So Allah tests you more and more. إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَى. When Allah loves a worshipper, He gives him a test. And the hadith says, إِظَمُ الْأَجْرِ مَعِظَمِ الْإِبْتِلَى. The bigger reward is with the bigger test. So when Allah took your child away, your spouse away, your limbs away, you are sick, you cannot move. May Allah grant shifa to all those who are sick and ill, no matter what disease they have. Ameen. Say ameen.
Ameen.
Subhanallah. May Allah grant shifa to all those who are sick and ill, no matter what disease they have. Ameen. Allahu Akbar. Sometimes we don't know our own diseases. Allah cured us from cancer without us knowing that we ever had cancer. It will happen, and it has happened, and it can happen, and we will find out only in the hereafter. Why? That's the love of Allah. You didn't even know what disease you had. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us good immune systems. That immune system, my dear heart, is actually a gift of Allah for you in order to protect you from diseases that are physical. So develop your spiritual immune system so that you can be protected from the trap of the devil who wants to take that deen away from you. My dear heart, remember, my dear heart, that you are going to return to Allah. Subhanallah. I was speaking about the tests. And I was telling you that you are only tested when you enter the school. Subhanallah. Think about that example. When you enter the school, you need to wear a certain uniform. If you don't, you will be expelled from the school, or you will have a problem with the headmaster. The same applies. You entered the school known as surrender to Allah. It's known as Islam. What happens? There is a uniform. Certain type of clothing you have to wear. You have to cover certain things. If you don't, you have a problem with Allah. That's the thing. And if you don't want to dress appropriately, you will have to pay the price. The world can say what it wants. They have paid the price. There was a study that was done not too long ago in the United States, where there was a woman who dressed semi-nude. And within a few hours, she had so many people harassing her. You know, the sexual harassment, people passing comments, looking this way, that way. And they were commenting about this, someone trying to grope her and touch her. And the other ones trying to do this and that and so on. Why? She was not dressed appropriately. She was showing her breast and her backside. And she was showing everything. And she was walking as though, well, with all the freedom on earth, right? She was walking with it. And she suffered the consequence. She suffered the consequence. And what happened? The very next day, wallahi, she walked with hijab. 7 hours, not one person even attempted to harass her. My dear heart, don't you learn the lesson? These were experiments done by those who don't even believe. But the results are there for you. We are only saying dress appropriately. That's all. Dress properly. It's an honor. You will find the calmness, the coolness of the heart. Oh my dear heart, you will be able to achieve the calmness when you want to please your maker. When you get up for Salatul Fajr, if you don't, oh my dear heart, there are millions of other hearts who actually do. So you are the one losing out. If you don't believe in Allah, Allah loses nothing. He says, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالَكُمْ. The end of Surah Muhammad, Allah says, if you turn away, we will replace you with someone else. They won't be like you. So it's you who's lost, not us. If a train is passing and you were too arrogant to jump on it, you miss the train, what will happen? You're not going to make it to Zamboanga in time for the lecture. Why? Because you didn't get up early enough, you didn't get to the station quick enough, or you were there and simply lazy to get on. So we are there at the time of Fajr but lazy to get onto the train. How are we going to make it to a place more important than Zamboanga, and that is Jannah? Wow, that's your train. Catch your train to Jannatul Firdaus. You are there, you are at the station, you just need to get up, catch your bags and jump into the train. What does that mean? Get up, wash yourself and read salah on the sajjada, on that prayer mat, and go for it. Your train into the akhirah. It will happen on a daily basis. Allah says, وَعْبُدَ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. How long should I continue reading the salah for? The answer is in that verse. Worship your maker. Worship the one who created you. رَبٌّ is a powerful word. It means he who created, who made you. Nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer, the one in whose hands lies the control of absolutely every aspect of existence, subhanallah. Allah says, worship him and him alone until the day you die. When you die, you have graduated from the school. Now what happens? I'm waiting for the prize giving. You know, now we have to wait for our results before we get into the next level. What's the next level? Jannatul Firdaus.
فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَهْ.
Oh my dear heart, a day will come when you will get your book either on the right hand or the left. This verse says, as for those who get their books in their right, or the one who gets his books in the right hand, he will say, hey, read my book. You know, a child very happy with the results that they have, right? When they have passed, when they have failed, what do they do? I don't know what happened to my results. They lost in the post. I don't know. Or when you see them, I think they mixed this up with someone else. You know, when I was writing my exam number, I think I made a mistake. No, you didn't study, you were lazy, you knew you had to work, subhanallah, but you didn't. So what happened? You are struggling. Who suffers the consequence of your deeds? وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. Allah says, no soul can take the burden of another. You have to take your own burden. May Allah forgive me. May Allah make it easy upon all of us. My brothers and sisters, the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu states very clearly that halal is very clear. That which is permissible is loud and clear. That which is prohibited is loud and clear. And in the middle, there are certain things that are grey. Grey meaning, you may not know the ruling of everything. Not all of us, including myself, we are not so knowledgeable. We know a few things and certain things we don't know. You might ask me things and I might have to tell you, listen, I don't know, I will try and find out. It's normal, because we are not all know-it-alls. Not at all. None of us are know-it-all, actually. So what happens? That area, Allah says in this beautiful hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which means the words are Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's words, but obviously it's from revelation in the sense that Allah inspires Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam what to say. So he said, whoever falls into that which they are doubting has fallen into haram. Whoever stays away has protected himself. فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. Whoever has stayed away from that which they are doubting has saved himself. If I were to tell you that there are five lions out there waiting to bite anyone who goes out, who will go out? Anyone? No one. But you know what? It might not be true. But now you're doubting, isn't it? Maybe it's there, maybe it's not there. Those who stayed in here, they lost nothing. Whether they were lions there, they were not bitten. And even if there were no lions there, they didn't lose anything. They were not bitten. They stayed here. Those who went out there, they risked their lives. And guess what? The lions were there. And immediately, and what happened? You quickly want to come running back. Well, you're lucky if you run back. Wallahi, with halal and haram, think of those lions. If you stay away, you didn't lose anything. This is meat. Someone says it's halal, someone says no, it's haram. The best thing, don't eat it. Why? That's the way we are taught. The Prophet ﷺ says, if you don't consume it, you've saved yourself. Nobody on earth can tell you it's haram to stay away. No. You've saved yourself. Is it farad to eat meat? No. Is it compulsory to eat meat? No. So I can stay away from it. It's fine. Now that I've stayed away from it, subhanallah, what happened to me? I protected myself. But the minute I start saying, no, there's a debate about it, it's okay, I'm jumping straight into the lions. That's what I'm doing. This is just an example. I'm talking of cleaning the heart. So the hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explains halal is clear, haram is clear, in the middle certain things, they may not be clear to you or to some. Whoever falls into them, falls into haram. Whoever protects themselves, stays away, has saved themselves. And has saved their deen, their faith. Then he says, Allah. In fact, he gives another example before he says Allah. He says, كَالْرَاعِ يَرْعَى حَوْلَ حِمًا يُوشِكُ أَنْ يَقَعَ فِيهِ. He says, this example is like the example of a shepherd who wants to graze his flock on territory that is borderline. He doesn't know whether it belongs to him or his neighbor. And he takes the flock all the way there. And he wants the flock to eat, to graze. The likelihood of that flock eating from the neighbor's grass is great. So the hadith says, in the body there is a heart. Ala wa inna fil jasadi la mudgha. Idha salahat salaha al jasadu kulluhu wa idha fasadat fasada al jasadu kulluhu. In fact, it's worded so beautiful. It says, in the body there is an organ. Initially, it's not mentioned that it's the heart that comes right at the end. But the hadith says, in the body there is an organ, or mudgha actually means a piece of flesh. More accurately, the word mudgha means a piece of flesh. The Prophet ﷺ is telling you, in your body there is a piece of flesh. If it is pure and good, the whole body will be pure and good. If it is dirty and filthy, the whole body will be dirty and filthy. He says, that organ is the heart. It's a piece of flesh. That's what it is. No bones. And it's just moving. How is it moving? Wallahi, I don't know. It's a miracle. Medicine cannot explain it. It's just muscle. The muscle moves. How? I don't know. Just Allah's qudra, Allah's power. It just keeps moving. Systole, diastole, and so on. It keeps on moving. That's what it is. And the chambers, the four chambers of this heart, and how it moves, and the oxygenated blood and deoxygenated blood. One goes in, one comes out, and goes to the brain and comes back. And what happens? It's a whole system. It works. I was about to say better than the traffic in Zamboanga, but Zamboanga is better, mashallah. Perhaps the traffic elsewhere. Imagine how all the roads go this way and that way, and then there's traffic coming here. This, it's more sophisticated than all the roads of the world. But the traffic flows. It just keeps on pumping. No jam, no stopping, no nothing. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. And you don't give Allah thanks for that, oh my dear heart. How can that happen? It's pumping by the qudra of Allah. And you know what I want you to do, my beloved brothers and sisters? Put your hand and feel the heart pumping. Feel it pumping, subhanallah. And you need to know that wallahi it's going to stop. That's what I want you to know. Don't think I'm dooming you. I'm doing it to myself as well. If that was the case, I wouldn't even tell you this. But that should make you closer to the Almighty. You have no option but to lay dead one day. No option. No matter how healthy you are, no matter how wealthy you are, no matter how powerful you are, all that left behind. Like I said, your deeds, do as much as you can. Give preference to others over your own heart in order to cleanse it over yourself. I have something and someone needs it more than I do. Are you ready to give it away today? The answer is no way, I'm not. It's called Al-Ithar. Allah describes the Ansar in Medina Munawwara. When the Muhajirin from Makkah made the hijrah and the migration and went to them, Allah says,
وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ.
Allahu Akbar. I just thought of something important. Allah speaks about how those who opened their doors in order to welcome their brothers and sisters who did not belong to their tribe, who did not belong to their chief, who did not belong to their part of the country, so to speak. The Ansar, they opened their hearts and their homes from the iman, the belief they had in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says they loved the Muhajirin. Ask yourself, do we love people from the north when we are here in the south? If they had a problem and they came to us, would we open our doors and say, welcome? When they propose for our daughters, we reject. That's not even asking you to come and be a refugee. What type of racism and tribalism has got into us? No wonder the heart is struggling. No wonder we are suffering. Because the heart needs to be cleansed. Wallahi, it needs to be cleansed. You need to clean your heart. Allah says the Muhajirin were totally different from the Ansar. Different tribe, different people. You know today, the people of Makkah and Medina are chalk and cheese. You know that. Those who have been there, they will tell you that wallahi in Medina they are calm. Makkah, they are rough and tough. Subhanallah, the mountains, rough and tough in Makkah. But when they came, you know what happened? Allah says,
يُحِبُّونَ مَنْ هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ حَاجَةً مِمَّا أُوتُوا.
They found in their hearts, they did not find in their hearts a need for what they were given by Allah. They gave it away to those who needed it more.
وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً.
They gave preference to others over themselves, even though they needed what they had and what they gave away. I need it, but he needs it more. That's what it means. I need it, but you need it more. Subhanallah, when I said this in one of my lectures, a young boy came up to me. He says, you know this cloak you're wearing, you need it, but I need it more. I looked at him and said, hey. Subhanallah, may Allah forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. Let's not misinterpret things. But anyway, going back on a more serious note, these people were mentioned by Allah, their sacrifice is mentioned by Allah, and then Allah caps this mention by saying,
وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ.
Whoever protects himself from, subhanallah, the miserliness, the stinginess of his own heart, of his own soul, he is the one, or those are the ones who are truly successful. Selfishness. When you are selfish, you want everything for yourself. This is mine, I won't share it, I don't want to share it, I'm not going to share it. Hang on. You may not share it, but you're going to pay a price for it. What will happen? The condition of your heart. Allah says, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Those will be the successful ones. Who? Those who can become selfless. Today the world teaches you to be selfish. It's all about me, myself and I. That's what it's all about. Everything is me. Something happens, hey, I must get. But we don't think, what about the other brother? What about the other sisters who are struggling and suffering? What about them? What about the orphans? What about the widows? What about those who are divorced? What about those who are disabled? What about the others who cannot manage? What about the poor? What about the needy? This is why the Prophet ﷺ, speaking about the heart again, speaks about how important it is to visit the sick and the ill. Because when you visit them, it softens your heart. That's what it is. Another hadith says, you visit the sick and the ill, you will find Allah there. What does that mean? That means that Allah's, subhanallah, Allah will have special mercy on you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will soften your heart. And you will get closer to Allah by visiting those who don't have what you have. But with us, we have the latest hairstyle or perfume or handbag or phone or car or house or kitchen or anything, or shoes or clothes or anything else. And someone has one model later. One, just one. iPhone 7, iPhone 8. What happened? I'm depressed. I'm sad. Something happened in my heart. I don't feel as happy as I was. Wallahi, wallahi. My dear heart, I'm speaking to you, not to the people here. May Allah forgive me. We feel hurt. Why? Hey, I just had the latest, no longer the latest. You run behind the world, it runs faster than you. Stop running. Make the most of what you have. You have a spouse, no problem. She'll develop stretch marks. Wow, those were your children, alhamdulillah. What else happens? She becomes old, perhaps. MashaAllah. Nowadays they gym and they make sure they're prim and prop even at the age of 50 and 60. Alhamdulillah. Thanks to the pressure of the globe. But when you become of a habit of wanting to change things that are updated, there comes a time when your heart will want to change your spouse also. Why? She's no longer the new model. The new models, they walk like that, you know. And my wife, she just straight, poor, simple thing. She just carries on. SubhanAllah. Wow. There was a stage when she was like that. Then what happened? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us contentment. If your heart is not in order, you will keep on running behind the world. You cannot have all the roses in the garden. You took your pick and now make the most of it. But if you keep on looking at all the roses in the garden, what happens? Do you know the ruling of lowering the gaze? Why is it there? For your heart. In order to save your heart from depression. I don't even know that the iPhone 8 exists. I don't know. And I don't want to know. I don't need to see it. I don't need to know what it does and what it doesn't do. Why? My iPhone 1, if there was ever one. My iPhone 1 is doing the purpose. It's fulfilling everything I need. What do I need to change things for? I don't. SubhanAllah. May Allah grant us an understanding. It's just an example. So, my beloved brothers and sisters, remember, when we run behind the world, it keeps on running faster. And we will keep on running until we drop into a pit known as the grave. We were running. While running, we dropped into the pit. Be happy with what you have. Be content. I'm not saying don't work to get something comfortable, to get a little bit more. If you can afford things, alhamdulillah, they should bring you closer to your maker. If your belongings and your spouse and your business and your looks and your power and your authority takes you away from Allah, you have lost. And if the same things bring you closer to Allah, you have gained. To have money is not bad, it's really good. Isn't it good to have some form of wealth? It's good. Only if that wealth comes with blessings. If there is no blessing in it, wallahi, it's not good. Let me explain. You earned 10 million. Okay, not pesos because the rate is quite bad. But let's say US dollars. You earned 10 million US dollars. Are you really going to spend all of that on yourself? Are you really going to spend all of that on yourself? Those who are billionaires, 99% of their wealth is not spent on them personally. They haven't eaten things. Have you thought about food? You know, what we do today, our hearts are so diseased that we pay for food that looks nice, but it's not healthy at all. We pay for food that tastes nice, but it's not healthy at all. And then we go later on, and then we want to start eating a little bit healthy. So the people have realized that when we charge more for the healthy food, people will buy that. SubhanAllah. Because they want to pay. People want to use. They want to spend. There was a time, I know, back in the days, when I was young, we never ever went out to eat. I don't remember my mom and dad once taking us out to eat anyway. Today, going out to eat, if you don't have it, your marriage is broken. I promise you. I officiated a nikah, and this is a very serious note. They made the groom, poor soul, I looked at him and I said, that's it, death sentence. They made him sign to say, her kitchen shall be closed Saturday and Sunday. Wow! Oh! He signed it. Take her out to eat. Where are you going to earn from? Beg, borrow, or steal? She has to eat out Saturday and Sunday for the rest of your life.
Whoa.
To sign is a little bit much. Don't you think so? Wallahi, it happened. I'm not joking with you. The world is coming to an end. You know, you might have a loving understanding. Listen, my darling, no problem. Inshallah, if we have a moment, we'll go somewhere. Perhaps we'll go out to eat. Come on, you're doing so much. Let me cook today. No sweat. These loving sort of agreements that you have, unwritten but filled with love, they bring about more contentment than something you made someone sign. But the problem is, people are letting one another down. That's why even when they signed it, they still break the agreement. You know, a long time ago, you could say something with your tongue, people would believe you. Today, the lawyers will come and make everybody sign with the whole community witnessing, and they will still break that agreement. It means nothing. And they will take you to court to prove that there's nothing wrong in me breaking this thing. May Allah forgive us. The world has changed. Why? The heart has changed. Where are the good hearts? I was talking about the Ansar and the Muhajireen, Makkah and Medina. Take a look at it. Allah is praising those who welcomed people from a different tribe into their homes. They married them to their daughters. They did. And Allah says they are the successful. Which means when you... Do you know what's the problem, my beloved brothers and sisters? Whether we like it or not, if not all of us, most of us have an element of racism in us. Whether we agree or we don't agree, we believe for some strange, stupid reason that we are better than someone whose complexion is a little bit darker sometimes, or than a person who comes from across the river, or from a person who comes from a different part of the same nation, or from someone who comes from another part of the world. Sometimes, somehow, somewhere, we tend to have this in the back of our minds. Why? We are contaminated. That's how the system makes us think sometimes. Islam tells you, لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأبيض على أسود إلا بالتقوى. There is no virtue of an Arab over a non-Arab. Nil, zero. Your birth was chosen by Allah. You are here in Basilan or in Zamboanga or wherever else solely because Allah chose that you will be here. You had no choice. If I had a choice, I would have been born in Makkah in the Haram. Subhanallah. I would have applied. And I'm sure all of us would have applied. Makkah, Medina, somewhere special, mashallah, where the prophets of Allah were, and so on. Or some people might want to be born where Bill Gates was born. But anyway, we didn't apply. What happened? Subhanallah. Allah chose it. So Allah says, I made everyone. Your heart needs to be clean enough to understand that He who made you, made the other one. I learned a lot in Africa where you see the poorest of the poor people, and wallahi the Quran they read is better than the richest of the rich. And wallahi the dedication they have is far more amazing than all others that I saw. I learned a lesson from it to say, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. People we never imagined. When I come to Zamboanga, for example, I see sisters, subhanAllah, dressed so well according to what Allah has required them to. And I just make a dua from my heart. It comes out automatically. Ya Allah, protect them. Grant them goodness. Make it easy for them. There are places in the world where they are banning dressing covering your head. Do you know that? They are banning it. It's not allowed. Are we waiting for that day? It's allowed. It's permissible. There is freedom. Make use of that freedom. Subhanallah. Like I told you, everything is there waiting. You just need to get up and you need to catch the train. But we are getting up, we're looking at the train, it's moving. We say, wow, the sisters on that train look quite nice. Well, when that train goes, there's another train with only brothers. What will happen? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Jump on the train. Come on, clean the heart and jump on it. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises the condition of those who can give preference to others over themselves. Give preference to people of a different tribe over themselves sometimes. What that means is, you need something, you feel for others. They are part of the same, they are creatures of the same maker. How the maker made you, he made them. When you get into the hereafter, there was a companion of the Prophet, peace be upon him, known as Bilal ibn Rabah. He was dark, he was from Africa. Why? Have you ever thought? Why did Allah choose for that one man to be a companion? Why did there have to be one man from Africa? Why? Have you ever thought of it? It wasn't a mistake of Allah. It was intentional to teach you a lesson.
And why, when Muhammad, peace be upon him, went up physically to Mi'raj into the heavens, when he came back, what did he do? He spoke to the same black man and he told him, "Oh Bilal, I heard your footsteps in paradise." Why was it Bilal in Jannah? Why wasn't it the others? To show you and I that wallahi, color means nothing. Never ever be a person whose heart is connected to complexion. No, it's a disease. It's a disease. If that is the case, your heart is dirty. Allahu Akbar. Why I'm worried? The hadith says, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. The hadith says, he will not enter Jannah. He will not enter paradise in whose heart is a mustard seed's weight worth of pride. What is pride? Despising people and rejecting the truth. You despise others, there is no place for you in heaven. You are an equal like others. The fadl and the virtue is to do with your closeness to Allah. That hadith says there is no virtue of a white man over a black or a black over a white except by taqwa. Taqwa means consciousness of Allah, the love of Allah. I mentioned this earlier and I want to say it again. The term taqwa, we always translate it as fear of Allah, right? We say the fear of Allah. Have you heard that? We've heard it, right? The fear of Allah. Taqwa is actually the love of Allah. I said it earlier, didn't I? Taqwa is the love of Allah that would prohibit you from transgressing because you are fearing displeasing the one you love. That's what it is. That's taqwa. At-taqwa an taj'ala baynaka wa bayna 'adhab Allahi wiqaya. Taqwa is to create a barrier between you and the punishment of Allah. I'm worshipping Allah because I love Him, not because I'm scared of Him. Allah is loving. Allah is ghafoor, forgiving, merciful. So I'm scared of His punishment, but not of Him. Do you see the difference? I'm scared of His punishment. As for Him, He's loving. I love Him. I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we say khawfun min Allahi, we are speaking of min iqabillahi wa ghadabihi. We are speaking of khawf, the fear from the punishment of Allah and His anger. We should be fearful to make Allah angry, just like we fear to make someone we love angry. When you desperately love someone, let's say your spouse or your child, you love someone, you fear to hurt them. You are scared. I don't want to say anything to hurt them. So you look at them and you say, in the sweetest possible way, "I love you." Wow. Why did you say it that way? Because you didn't want to tell them. Even if you said, "I love you," they'd say, "Ah, look at this. Look at your emotion. Emotionless, I love you." Imagine your husband comes to you, hey. You say what? "Love you." That doesn't work. You tell him, "What do you mean? I almost thought you were going to shout me. Hey, love you." Love what? Say it, "Love you." That's okay. Just with your eyes. Even if you just say, they will understand. It's over. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. My brothers and sisters, beautiful lessons we learned. But I need to share with you a few more things. Hypocrisy also lies within the heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it in many places in the Quran. يَقُولُونَ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ مَا لَيْسَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. People say with their mouths what is not in their hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. In their hearts is a disease. What is the disease? They are hypocrites. They are not living a real life. Be yourself. Be happy with what Allah has given you. Wallahi, it will clean your heart. I can speak about this from many angles, but I want to speak about it from a physical perspective to begin with. What is that? I'm a Muslim. MashaAllah, I've grown my beard, for example. I'm doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're a sister, for example. You know how to dress. You're dressing for the sake of Allah. You don't need to hide your identity to be hypocritical. You love Allah. Let it happen. Let it go. Let it flow. A lot of the times, my mothers and sisters, look, I'm going to address an issue that there is a crisis regarding in today's world. What is it? It is makeup. You know makeup? You see, no one said yes because they know. Did you hear that? I tell you something. Makeup, I don't want to talk about the use of makeup. I want to talk about the abuse of makeup. Abusing it. Today people are abusing this in such a way that their hearts become so attached to it that their own identity is an insult to themselves. That's the problem. Stop it. Don't go to that level. Within limits, okay, fine. Let it pass. But it becomes beyond the limit. Every day you paste 2 inches of icing on your cake. That's not good. One day it looks like a strawberry cake. The other day, orange cake. The next day, banana cake. Every day, a different type of a cake. What is this? That's what I'm saying. Your husband will kiss someone else. Because you say, hey, wait, my lipstick. Hey, my lipstick. Don't touch. How can you keep on doing that? May Allah forgive us. So this is why I say, there needs to be some form of a limit. Be happy, content with what Allah has given you. That's my face, that's my body. Allah's given me. I try my best to maintain it. It doesn't mean, oh, I'm a Muslim, I must lose my body. No, you maintain it. You can also participate in the exercise, perhaps in the gymming within limits. I'm not promoting gymming in a haram way where, you know, it's free for all and suddenly hijab and whatever else is all disregarded. No, but there are permissible ways. You can do it at home or with a group of your own sisters and so on. But you look after the body and then you say, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave this to me. Someone somehow, somewhere will love it. And this is why I strongly encourage between spouses, between children and parents, to praise one another's physique. Come what may. Just look at your spouse and look at them and look at them again and look at them and start smiling. Subhanallah. And just say, hey, mashallah, tabarakallah. Can't believe your mind. Can't believe it. But you need to look. And you need to look really like this, you know. Allahu Akbar. I promise you, when you learn from each other, when you appreciate each other, you help each other. You help clean the heart, because then your spouse knows you appreciate me for who I am. You don't appreciate Mac instead of me. You understand what that means? Sometimes a man will come and say, wow, you're looking stunning. It's not me looking stunning, it's the Mac on me that's looking stunning. Be honest. Allahu Akbar. May Allah forgive us. My brothers and sisters, I've overshot my time. But then again, it's Zambawanga. You know, it starts with a Z. So we are from A all the way to Z. They put me the last speaker because I also come from Zambawabwe. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So alhamdulillah, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity. We spoke about the heart. I hope that we have seen some angles regarding the heart. Remember, the cleanest of hearts are those that worship Allah alone. Like I started at the beginning, I said that Allah wants us to worship Him. I even read the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He has only created mankind and jinnkind, or not created them for any purpose but to worship Him, which means to fulfill what He wants you to fulfill on earth. Learn to cleanse this heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to protect ourselves from association and partnership with Him. And may He give us the ability to follow strictly the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May we become the best of people, such that we can cleanse ourselves and our hearts. May we learn to love one another and to spread the goodness for one another, to rid the heart of the dirt such as jealousy, envy, hatred, the love of the world, and so on and so forth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.